Today in this video, we will learn about cell. Friends, have you ever thought what are living beings like humans, plants or animals made up of? Well, let's see. If we zoom all these living creatures, you can see small compartments. These compartments are called cells. Hence, it can be said all living beings are made up of cells, and the cell is the smallest unit from which all living beings are made. Cell is the fundamental unit of life. Friends, can you see them with your naked eyes? No, these cells are so small that they cannot be seen with naked eyes. If you want to see them, then you can see with the help of microscope, which you can find in your school biology laboratory. Well, a question must be arising in your mind that the cell which is so difficult to see, how difficult it must have been to find out about it? First, let's see how the cell was discovered. In the 1590s, a scientist named Zacharias Janssen invented the first real compound microscope. Then, in 1665, a great biologist named Robert Hooke examined the bark of a tree in the compound microscope, and he found out that the bark of this tree had many small cells whose structure is similar to beehive. They called these blocks a cell. Cell in a Latin word means small room or a compartment. So, in this way, Robert Hooke discovered the cell. After further research, it was found that all living beings are made up of cells. The cell is the fundamental unit of life. All cells come from previously present cells. That is, the first present cell divides and forms two new cells. And these are the postulates of cell theory. Now, friends, do you think, are all the living beings made of same cell or different? Yes, you're correct. All living beings do not look alike. So, how can they be made of same cells? Not only this, many types of cells are found in multicellular organisms like humans. For example, muscle cells are of this type of structure. Other cells like blood cells, bone cells, sperm, and nerve cells are of this type. Hence, all cells are different and the structure of cell are according to their work. And if you look at the size of the cells, then some cells are very small, which cannot be seen from the eyes, such as bacteria, which is about 0.1 to 0.5 micron in size. And the largest cell is of ostrich egg with the size of 170 millimeters into 130 millimeter. Did you see how many types of cells are found? Now, let us see how these cells look like. This is human and this is a plant. After zooming, the cell that you are looking at is an animal cell and this is a plant cell. How is their structure? Do you know? Let's see. This is a plant cell. Its outermost layer is called the cell wall. This cell wall is found only in the plant cells. It is not found in animal cells. After this, you can see the layer in the animal cell. This is called the cell membrane or plasma membrane. This layer is found in both plants and animal cells. The spherical thing you can see is called the nucleus. The area between the nucleus and the plasma membrane is called cytoplasm. Other than this, cells have very important parts which are surrounded by a layer called cell organelle. These cell organelles float in cytoplasm and have their own important work. Let's see them. This is endoplasmic reticulum. The black dots on the side of endoplasmic reticulum is called ribosomes. The endoplasmic reticulum containing ribosomes is called rough endoplasmic reticulum. And those which do not have ribosomes are called smooth endoplasmic reticulum. After this, this is Golgi apparatus. And this is called lysosomes. And this is called mitochondria. This is plastid, which is found only in plant cells. And now, these are vacuoles, which are very large in plant cells and very small in animal cells. So friends, this is all about the structure of the cell. So what did we learn in this video? Cell is the fundamental unit of life. Robert Hooke discovered the cell in the year 1665. Different types of cells are found in all living beings. One cell divides to form two new cells. Cells have various cell organelles like nucleus, mitochondria, ribosome, lysosome, etc. Now, we will learn about cell envelope and osmosis. Hello everyone, welcome back. Earlier, we discussed about the structure of cell. In this video, we will discuss about cell envelope and osmosis. First, we will learn about cell envelope. Well friends, do you know what is a cell envelope? You must have understood by the term itself that we are going to understand the outermost layers of the cell. Let's understand what is a cell envelope. It is made up of cell wall and cell membrane. First, let us know what is a cell wall. Cell wall. This is the outermost layer and it is present only in the plant cell. It surrounds the entire plant cell. Friends, you must have noticed that the plants are a bit rigid and complex. So, what could be the reason for this? Yes, because of this cell wall, as it is made up of complex substance called cellulose. It is very thick and rigid and provides structural support to the plant. So, what if the outermost layer of the cell is rigid? Yes, this will maintain the safety and the structure of the cell. It is a permeable membrane and a vital part of the cell. That is, this layer allows small particles to go in or out. And no organic chemical reaction takes place in it. Can you tell why are cell walls only in plant cells but not in animal cells? Just think. So, the answer is that plants live in the open environment and face bad weather like storm, hail or excess heat or very cold. That is why thick and hard cell walls are for greater protection. But animals can go to a safe place. That is why they do not need any additional protection. Let's understand another protective layer, and that is cell membrane or plasma membrane. Cell membrane or plasma membrane is the outermost layer of the animal cell. It separates the parts of the cell from the external environment and it is present in both plant and animal cells. It is made up of proteins and lipids, which are very important biological molecules. Many cell organelles of the cell are made up of these biological molecules. It is a semi-permeable membrane. Now, what is this semi-permeable membrane? The semi-permeable membrane allows the passage of certain particles and stops the movement of other particles. That is why it is the living part of the cell. It maintains the size of the cell and also protects the internal structure of the cell. Now friends, what if the cell does not have a cell membrane? Friends, if you look at the animal cell, it is the same outer layer that gives it shape. If it is not present, then everything present inside will come out. But in plant cell, there is a cell membrane which gives shape and there is a cell wall around it, which provides protection to both the cell membrane and the cell. So friends, have you seen what is cell envelope? But do you know how particles move in this cell envelope? Let's understand. There are two ways, diffusion and osmosis. What is diffusion? Guys, have you ever heard the term diffusion? Diffusion is the process in which solid, liquid, and gaseous substances move from high concentration to low concentration. For example, cell requires oxygen to produce energy. Let's understand. When the oxygen gas molecules reach the cell with the blood, the concentration of oxygen molecules outside the cell becomes higher than inside. So, what will happen here, friends? Yes, diffusion will occur. The oxygen molecules move from outside to the inside of the cell, and when the cell makes energy, carbon dioxide, that is CO2 gas, is produced in the cell, which has to go outside. Now, the concentration of carbon dioxide gas molecules in the cell is higher than outside. So, what will happen here? Tell, again, the same diffusion. The movement of the molecules of carbon dioxide gas will be from inside to outside of the cells. So, in this way, the gases in the cell are transported by diffusion process. The second mode of transportation is osmosis. It is the process in which water moves from higher concentration to a low concentration through a semi-permeable membrane. In order to understand, let's perform an activity. Activity. Take two glasses, A and B. Add some water in glass A, then glass B. Now, mix equal amounts of sugar or salt in them and make a solution. Now, if both these solutions are compared, the concentration of water in glass A is higher than that of glass B. So, the solution of glass A will be called a hypotonic solution. While the concentration of water in glass B is lower than glass A, the solution of glass B is called hypotonic solution. Now, take another glass C, add the same amount of water and sugar or salt as you have taken in glass A. Now, if both glasses A and C are compared here, then the concentration of water in both will be the same. So, both solutions will be called isotonic solutions to each other. Similarly, take another glass D in which we will keep the amount of water and the quantity of sugar or salt as glass B. Now, here, when glass B and glass D are compared, then the concentration of water in both will be same. That is, both glass B and glass D will also be called isotonic solutions to each other. Now, friends, what will happen if you put a cell into these solutions? Let's see. First of all, put the cell in the hypotonic solution. In this solution, the concentration of water is less than that of the cell. So guys, what will happen here? Yes, osmosis. The water of the cell will come out of the plasma membrane and gradually the size of the cell will decrease. Now, put the cell in the hypotonic solution. Here, the concentration of water in the solution is higher than that of the cell. So guys, what do you think will happen? Yes, same, osmosis again. The water of the solution will enter the cell through the plasma membrane and the size of the cell increases. Now, what will happen if the cell is put in the same isotonic solution? Yes, you are thinking right. Here, there will be no transport of water at all because both have the same water concentration. Well, through this osmosis process, only plants absorb water from the soil. Let's see how. For example, here this plant is planted on the soil. There will also be water in the land and many salts dissolved in it. These salts are very important for the plants. Now, the amount of water in the root cells is less in the plant. So, the groundwater will act as a hypotonic solution. So friends, what should happen here? Yes, osmosis. The groundwater goes through the plasma membrane of the root cell into the cell and the cell swells and becomes thick. So friends, in this way, osmosis causes the transport of water and salts in plants. Summary: cell envelope is made up of cell wall and plasma membrane. In the next video, we will understand regarding nucleus and cytoplasm. To this video. Friends, so far we have learned about cell wall and cell membrane. In this video, we will learn about nucleus and cytoplasm. So first of all, let us understand cytoplasm. Friends, what do you think? Where cytoplasm is present in a cell? Yes, we have already learned in the cell structure that the part between the nucleus and the plasma membrane in the cell is called the cytoplasm. It is a jelly-like fluid. Well friends, what could be the reason for it being jelly-like? Friends, because of its jelly-like nature, all the cell organelles like mitochondria, Golgi apparatus, lysosomes, etc. float in it and the required proteins of these cell organelles swim in the cytoplasm and reach them. Apart from this, it also maintains the texture of the cell and all the chemical reactions also takes place in the cytoplasm, which is responsible for the cell to survive. Now, let's understand about nucleus. You have already seen that in both plant and animal cells, there is a spherical thing in the center. Guys, what do you think? What is it? Yes, it is the nucleus. It is the center of the cell from which everything will be directed. Just as the brain in our body directs and controls all the processes, such as breathing, digestion, excretion, vision, movement, etc. In the same way, the nucleus of the cell also directs and controls all processes. If we zoom in the nucleus, you can notice that it is spherical in shape. Its outer structure is a two-layer membrane called nuclear membrane. It is same as that of the cell membrane of the cell. So friends, what do you think? Its function and structure would be similar to cell membrane? Yes, its function and structure is similar to the cell membrane of a cell, which keeps the things inside the nucleus separate from the other parts of the cell. You can also notice many small holes in its layer. These are called nuclear pores. Inside the nucleus, there is a jelly-like fluid and it is called nucleoplasm. Now, does this nuclear pores allow the passage of nucleoplasm into cytoplasm? What do you think? Well, yes, it does. And the nucleus and the cytoplasm together is called protoplasm. Apart from this, you can also notice a spherical part in the center of the nucleus, which is called nucleolus. Now, we will understand about the function of the nucleus. By the way, you must have understood the center of the cell is the headquarters, which controls and directs all metabolic activities such as production of energy, etc. It determines the overall growth and maturity of the cell. It also plays a central role in the cellular reproduction of cells. So friends, you must be thinking now, do cells also reproduce? Yes, reproduction occurs in cells as well. In this process, one cell divides into two new cells, and the information and instructions in the new cell that is formed by cell reproduction go through the nucleus. Let's understand how it happens. Friends, you can see some thread-like structure in the nucleus. These are called chromatin. Do you know about chromatin? If we look closely at this thread-like structure, here it is a coiled chromatin. The dots you see in the middle is a protein called histone protein. And the structure of this thread is called DNA. The full form of DNA is deoxyribonucleic acid. So, it can be said that the chromatin is made up of DNA and protein. But friends, what is this DNA? Have you ever heard this name? You must have heard about DNA tests in the movies or serials. This DNA test is done whenever the parents of a person has to be found out. Well, let's understand about this DNA. This is how DNA looks like. The coding you see in the middle of the structure is the information or instructions. Information like what will be the structure of the cell, what will be the work, and how will be the structure of body also be, etc. The way a book contains information, the DNA contains information or instructions related to the cell. So, it can be said that the DNA molecule contains the necessary information about the structure, formation, and organization of the cell. The information that is in DNA is called gene. That is, gene is called the characterization of DNA. Now, what is the role of genes? Just think. Well, when a cell divides, then the chromatin gets organized into a structure called chromosome. Now, you can see a lot of chromosomes in the nucleus of the cell. This means that the cell is about to divide. And when the cell divides, some part of chromosome migrates to the new cell. So friends, in this way, through genes of DNA, instructions goes into the new cell. So it can be said that in inheritance, information is passed through the genes of DNA. Similarly, in children, information or instructions come through the genes of DNA of parents. Well, I guess you must have got an idea what happens when DNA tests are done in movies or serials. This is all about the nucleus and its functions. Now friends, based on the presence of nuclear membrane, cells are of different types. Let's understand this as well. In some organisms like bacteria, the nuclear region of the cell may be poorly defined, due to which absence of a nuclear membrane, such as undefined nuclear region containing only chromatin, is called a nucleoid. Such organisms whose cells lack a nuclear membrane are called prokaryotes. We call such cells as prokaryotic cells. Pro means primitive or primary, and karyote means nucleus. In these cells, many cell organelles are absent. An organism with cells having a nuclear membrane are called eukaryotes. They contain all the cell organelles. Examples like plant cell and animal cell. Summary. So friends, we learned about cytoplasm and nucleus in this video. Cytoplasm is a jelly-like fluid that contains cell organelle. And DNA present in the nucleus contains cell-related information, and this information goes through genes into new cells. On the basis of presence of nuclear membrane in the nuclear region, the cell can be categorized into two groups, prokaryotic cell and eukaryotic cell. Next, we will learn about cell organelles. Welcome all of you in this video. We studied nucleus and cytoplasm. Come, let's learn about cell organelles. Friends, do you know what cell organelles are? Yes, we will learn about the parts found inside the cell and their functions. All eukaryotic cells use small membranous structures called cell organelles to perform their metabolic or chemical reactions and help in work done in the body of multicellular complex structures such as plants and animals. These are cell organelles: nucleus, endoplasmic reticulum, Golgi apparatus, mitochondria, blastids and vacuoles. We have already learned about the nucleus. Now, we will learn about the endoplasmic reticulum. It is a very large system of membrane-bound ducts and sheaths. Its composition is similar to that of cell membrane. Friends, if you look at it carefully under the microscope, do you see any difference in their structure? Yes, somewhere there are black dots, while rest it is absent. The endoplasmic reticulum that has black dots is called a rough endoplasmic reticulum, and which do not have dots are called smooth endoplasmic reticulum. Do you know what these black dots are? These black dots are called ribosomes. These are spherical in shape and extremely dense. It is made up of ribonucleic acid and protein. Their main function is protein synthesis. Friends, do you know where they are made in the cell? They are formed in the nucleoplasm of the nucleus. After getting formed, it comes out of the nuclear pores and stick to the endoplasmic reticulum, which is then called rough endoplasmic reticulum. Friends, do you know? On the rough endoplasmic reticulum, protein synthesis occurs with the help of these ribosomes, and smooth endoplasmic reticulum helps in the formation of fat and lipid molecules. That is, the endoplasmic reticulum provides a large surface for synthesis of protein and lipid inside the cell, and after that, it also gives them a way to go to other parts of the cell as needed. Some proteins and lipids help to form cell membranes. This process is called membrane biogenesis. And some proteins and lipids acts as enzymes and hormones. So friends, it's the endoplasmic reticulum that gives way to synthesize basic biological molecules of the cell and move them to different parts of the cell. Now, we will understand about next cell organelle, Golgi apparatus. It is also called Golgi body or Golgi complex. It was discovered in the cell in 1898 by Camillo Golgi. It consists of a system of membrane-bound vesicles arranged approximately parallel to each other in stacks called cisterns. Golgi apparatus also have circular vesicles and tubules. The Golgi apparatus synthesizes substances like proteins and lipids from endoplasmic reticulum via vesicles and then stores, modifies and packs and sends to different location outside or inside the cell. For this reason, it is also called the post office of the cell. Lysosomes are also produced by the Golgi apparatus. Now, we will study about lysosomes. Lysosomes are membrane-bound sacs that have very powerful digestive enzymes which break down all organic matter. But friends, where do these powerful digestive enzymes come from? Well, these digestive enzymes are formed on smooth endoplasmic reticulum and packed in lysosomes from the vesicles of the Golgi apparatus. Guys, what is the function of lysosomes? Well, inside the cell, the broken parts of cell organelles and the residual material coming from outside, such as bacteria, food, etc., go into the lysosome and its digestive enzymes break it into small pieces and cleanse the cell. And when the cell is damaged or dead due to any reason, the lysosomes burst and the enzymes digest their own cells. Hence, the lysosomes is called the suicidal sac of the cell. So, in this way, the lysosome works to keep the cell clean. Friends, we will now learn about mitochondria. Mitochondria is a double-layered membrane. One is the outer membrane and the other is the inner membrane. The outer membrane is porous and the inner membrane is deeply folded. Do you know, guys, where does the cells get energy to perform its essential function? Yes, from mitochondria. The mitochondria have their own DNA and ribosomes that can make proteins and energy in the inner membranes. Mitochondria provides energy in the form of ATP, that is adenosine triphosphate, to the cell to perform the necessary chemical reactions. For this reason, it is also called the powerhouse of the cell. So guys, you saw mitochondria make energy for a cell. Now, we will know about plastid, the next cell organelle. Do you know, guys, plastid is present only in the plant cells? There are three types of plastid: chloroplast, chromoplast, and leucoplast. Chloroplast is green in color, chromoplast is colored, and leucoplast is colorless. Let's know about them. First is chloroplast. Friends, do you know why plants are green in color? Because of this chloroplast. It contains green pigment called chlorophyll, which gives green color to plants. Not only this, it also helps in photosynthesis. It is a double membrane cell organelle. Its inner structure consists of layers of membranes with a thylakoid located in a fluid called stroma. Now, we will know about chromoplast. Friends, have you ever thought why leaves, fruits, and flowers of a plant are of different colors? Well, because of this chromoplast. They are colored plastids and it provides different colors in leaves, flowers, and fruits. Now, we will know about leucoplast. Friends, It is a colorless plastid in which substances like starch, oil, and protein are stored. Friends, do you know? Plastid also have their own DNA and ribosomes, which help in synthesis of protein and light. So friends, now we will know about next cell organelle, vacuoles. Friends, do you know where all necessary substances are stored in the cell? Yes, in the vacuoles of the cell. Vacuole is a collector of liquids and solid substances such as amino acids, sugars, many types of organic acids, proteins, etc., which are very essential substances for plants. Do you know, guys? Their size is small in the animal cell, whereas in the plant cell, vacuoles are very large. Friends, you will be surprised to know that in some plant cells, their measurement is from 50% to 90% of the volume of the cell, because of which the nucleus is near the plasma membrane. In plant cells, vacuoles are full of cell sap and provides turgidity and rigidity to the cell. In single-celled organisms like amoeba, the food vacuole contains the food items that the amoeba has consumed. In some unicellular organisms, specialized vacuoles also play important roles in expelling excess water and some waste from the cell. So, in this video, we learned about different cell organelles like nucleus, endoplasmic reticulum, Golgi apparatus, mitochondria, plastids, and vacuole.